غرباء 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 غرباء.
إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا، من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له، وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله. أما بعد، السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. Welcome everyone inshallah to our talk today, preparing for Ramadan. Just a slight change to the program. On our poster we said that we'll be having Shaykh Muhammad Ali from Sheffield. Unfortunately, due to an illness in his family, he could not attend today. So we pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that he gives shifa to his mother who is ill at the moment. But alhamdulillah, Allah has blessed us with someone we consider better inshallah. Shaykh Abdul Muhsin, who at the last minute has saved us, and inshallah he will be covering the topic today, which is preparing for Ramadan. I don't want to take any more of your time inshallah, and I will pass the mic straight on to Shaykh Abdul Muhsin, who doesn't need any introduction.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين، وأصلي وأسلم على أشرف خلق الله أجمعين، نبينا محمد عليه وعلى آله وصحابته أفضل الصلاة وأتم التسليم. I'd like to start by praising Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the Almighty, the Most Exalted, the Most High, and send peace and blessings upon our most beloved Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala ease my task today. I'm not a bitter person, but subhanallah, I wished that I was among the audience and any of the shuyukh will be given the talk, but alhamdulillah, you need to be patient. My main point on this topic for today inshallah is to assess ourselves with all the worships that we've been doing in our lives, because every ibadah, every worship that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has decreed upon us has an impact, must be shown at least to you in front of yourself, not in front of others, but you must leave this ibadah, must leave something, leave an impact on you, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the most wise. When a manufacturer in any field manufacture any device, it will give you some buttons here and there, صح? And each of these buttons has an impact. If you press this, this is an on off, right? This is enter. This is, so when you press an enter, return, or on and off, and it doesn't show anything, there must be something wrong. صح? Is it? All the indicators in your car, each and every single indicator was made for a purpose. صح? When you see the indicator for fuel is going down and you did not pay attention to it, it will give you a light, صح? Just to tell you, pay attention, you're running out of fuel, صح? Out of fuel, right? Then you need to act, صح? So every ibadah has indicators, and every business, they have something called KPIs, key performance indicators, to tell you whether you are progressing toward the right path or are you deviating. So has Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala given us anything like this? Any impact, any indicators? Wallahi, the Quran is full with indicators. And the vast majority of us sometimes do not pay attention to these indicators. For example, what is our relationship between us and the Holy Quran? I will start with this and I will keep repeating this until I die, concentrating and focusing on the treasures in the Holy Quran that we have been overlooking or we have been missing. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given us this Quran to feel something. You must feel something. Don't concentrate on how many verses do you say with your tongue or how many verses you've read. La. Look how many verses have crossed down from either your ears or your tongue while reciting or from your eyes while looking at the Quran, has penetrated all these barriers and touched your heart. Here is the ultimate goal. Wallahi, this is the ultimate destination. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has specified this and has subhanahu wa ta'ala explained this, detailed it in the Holy Quran. Allah says subhanahu wa ta'ala in the Holy Quran, كِتَابٌ أَنزَلْنَاهُ إِلَيْكَ مُبَارَكٌ. That this is the Holy Quran, this is the Holy Book, this is the book that is full with blessings that we've revealed down onto you. Someone would ask a logical question, why? What is the main purpose of having the Quran before our hands? Why? What is, if someone interviewed you and he said, please, can you tell me within just a short sentence, why, what is the main purpose of sending the Holy Quran down to you? Just for 20 seconds, give me the reason, why, the rationale behind sending the Quran down to you. What would you say? Are you ready? Do you feel what you would be saying? Allah says,
كِتَابٌ أَنزَلْنَاهُ إِلَيْكَ مُبَارَكٌ لِيَدَّبَّرُوا آيَاتِهِ.
That we've sent, this is the Holy Quran that we have sent down unto you, so you may contemplate over the verses of the Holy Quran. So you may ponder over the verses. Contemplation? Pondering, we just recite. Sah? Mainly we recite. No. It is contemplation. This is the book for contemplation. This is the book that may take you from the materialistic life to live a life that is totally different than others. Wallahi.
لِيَدَّبَّرُوا آيَاتِهِ وَلِيَتَذَكَّرَ أُولُو الْأَلْبَابِ.
There is an example that I have been repeating on and on and on, and I must repeat it now, because that's my message, my mission on the life, to get this message crossed. We have many patients in hospitals where they are fed through an NG tube, nasogastric tube, a tube that is being stuck down from the nose all down to the stomach. If we decide to visit one of those patients, may Allah grant them swiftly recovery, Ya Rabbil Alameen. If we just go with the best and the most pure honey on the face of the earth, and we paid all what we have to purchase, this is the purest honey on the face of the earth, and we pour it down the tube, all the 1 kg, and then we asked the patient, what do you think of the honey? What would he say? He would say, which honey? Sah? Which honey? And he's honest in his answer. What if you take only the one drop that is left in the bottle and you give it to someone with his tongue and you ask him, what do you think? You don't need to ask him. He will be throwing many questions on you and said, well, from where did you get it? How much did you pay for it? He will ask you, why? What is the difference between the two guys? Why this one felt it and this one doesn't feel anything? Although the amount is incomparable, right? 1 kg versus one drop. But the one drop reaches its ultimate destination, which is التقدير. The right destination. صح? So how would, what is the tool of tasting the flavors? It's a tongue. So if you put the honey in my hand, I won't give you any reaction. If you put it in my head, I won't tell you that it is sweetie. It is the most delicious, scrumptious honey. No, but just give me one drop, but in the right place. That's why when you pray, you will find people, when you pray, when you recite, you will find people are dealing with the Quran differently because the Quran hits different parts of the or of the body. Some people just concentrating on the memory and how to memorize the Holy Quran. Some of them just concentrating and focusing on how much have they read. Some of them asking themselves with each verse, what have I understood? Has it reached the final destination? That's why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala prescribed it. He says subhanahu wa ta'ala, أَفَلَا يَتَدَبَّرُونَ الْقُرْآنَ. Don't they then contemplate on the Holy Quran? Look how beautifully the ayah, the verses been formulated. أَفَلَا, don't they then? While you're reciting this, you're asking yourself, Allah is asking you, أَفَلَا, don't you then? يَتَدَبَّرُونَ. They have been reciting, but don't they then start something else? Contemplate, ponder over the verses. أَفَلَا يَتَدَبَّرُونَ الْقُرْآنَ أَمْ عَلَىٰ قُلُوبٍ. Or their hearts are backed up. Why would Allah subhanahu mention the hearts here? Because it is the tool to taste the flavor of the Holy Quran. وَإِنَّهُ لَتَنْزِيلُ رَبِّ الْعَالَمِينَ. Indeed, it is the revelation of the Lord of the universe. Look at the destination. From the starting point to the end point. نَزَلَ بِرُوحُ الْأَمِينَ. Gabriel, has taken the Quran from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala down to where? عَلَىٰ قَلْبِكَ. Gabriel has brought the Quran onto which part of the body of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? On the heart. عَلَىٰ قَلْبِكَ لِتَكُونَ مِنَ الْمُنْدَرِينَ. So it is, my main question is always, how much of what I have recited has crossed to my heart? If we know this, let's now start with the Siyam. To see what the Quran is giving you now, the indicator. How to prepare for the holy month, and how would you assess yourself if you're progressing? And not only that, how much have you progressed? Look what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says.
يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا.
Oh, who you believe.
يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا كُتِبَ عَلَيْكُمُ الصِّيَامِ.
Decreed upon you is fasting Ramadan. Are we the only one nation that this fasting has been decreed upon? No.
كما كتب على الذين من قبلكم.
As it was decreed upon the people before you. What is the last sentence in the ayah? This is the KPI.
لعلكم.
If you want to assess yourself of the siyam, Allah didn't say كتب عليكم الجوع, decreed upon you hunger. No. That is an indicator for the people who don't know. They think that the Ramadan is to taste the hunger and the thirst. No, Allah didn't say this. This is not an indicator. So what is the indicator?
لَعَلَّكُمْ
تَتَّقُونَ. What does it mean? That you may become righteous. What does this indicator? What does progressing in ibadah, what does increasing in the fear of Allah and the hope and the love of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has to do with my hungry stomach, empty stomach. He, the Quran, explains how. That's why if you bring this bottle of water to me in 15 days time, or to anyone who believes in Allah, and you give him this bottle with a check of £1 million, and you say, just take one sip, take the check of £100. Do you think he would accept the deal? Wallahi, a believer will never. He will just give you a dirty look and say, what are you talking about? Subhanallah, are you Bill Gates? you just think that you don't need this £1 million? No, he maybe, if you look at his pocket, he may not have a one penny. Yet he would say, get out of my way. Subhanallah. If you give him 2 millions, one sip, he would say no. 100 million for one drop. Wallahi, he won't do it. The believer will never do it. Subhanallah. Why? If you ask him, why? How would you miss this deal? He would say, because I know that if a drop of water just passes through my tongue, to my throat, to my esophagus, Allah will see it. And he won't be happy, subhanahu wa ta'ala, that I disobeyed him and it is one drop. This will tell you how strong you are in facing the lusts. It is water, it is not alcohol. It is water, guys. Look at this, is the impact that must be left in your heart, because you feel how strong I am, that I waited and I am ready to just reject any offer. I might have no job yet. I don't have a house. I don't have anything, but wallahi, you cannot seduce me with this. This will tell you, this is a lesson that will tell a Muslim, a believer, you are so strong. You are so strong. You see, now it is not the hunger, it is not the thirst. That's why the Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam said, مَنْ لَمْ يَدَعْ قَوْلَ الزُّورِ وَالْعَمَلَ بِهِ وَالْجَهْلِ فَلَيْسَ لِلَّهِ حَاجَ فِي أَنْ يَدَعَ طَعَامَهُ وَشَرَابَهُ. What does that mean? The Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam is emphasizing on that indicator, and that on that impact, on that something, that thing that you must feel, not say, you feel. He says, مَنْ لَمْ يَدَعْ قَوْلَ الزُّورِ. Whoever is not ready to leave the rubbish words, the bad words against people, backbiting, whatever. وَالْعَمَلَ بِهِ, lying and acting with bad deeds. فَلَيْسَ لِلَّهِ حَاجَةٌ. Allah does not need him to leave his food and drink. فَلَيْسَ لِلَّهِ حَاجَةٌ فِي أَنِّ. So there are something that is beyond the hunger and thirst that Allah subhanahu wants us to feel. He wants you to feel that you're strong. And you, if someone, if I'm feeling this indicators, I'm living the holy month as it should be, wallahi, I would say to myself, if I am a smoker, I would say, I rejected a water for 1 million, 2 millions, billions. So, for the sake of Allah, I'm so strong to quit smoking. It is a 1 month training course. It is an extensive training course to tell you who you are, to tell you that you are strong. You are so strong. Your wife in the same house and you don't touch her all the day long. Subhanallah. She's my wife. And if you have an, intersexual course with your wife, you will be rewarded. And she will be rewarded too. So, if I'm leaving it, I'm just training myself. So, okay, if I'm doing this with my wife and I proved that I can do it while me and her in the same room, then I'm so strong to prevent myself from something that is originally prohibited. You get my point? So the Quran is telling you that, pushing you, Siyam, pushing you all to the end to show you how strong you are. So the main issue here is, what is the impact of this ibadah? That's why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, فَإِنْ سَابَّهُ أَحَدٌ أَوْ شَاتَمَهُ, when someone stimulates you, tries to trigger you by saying bad words against you or something, فَلْيَقُلْ, then he must say, or let him say, what? إِنِّي صَائِمٌ or إِنِّي جَائِعٌ, I am fasting or I am hungry. Really? No, because you must know it. That indicates that you are hungry, that indicates you are righteous. لَعَلَّكُمْ تَتَّقُونَ, that you can do it, but you prevent yourself for the sake of Allah. So here is an impact, here is a KPI, this is an indicator that you are progressing. In Sha'ban, someone stimulates you, you may just at least say or give the bad words, although it is not the best action, but you may say exactly the same word, not to exceed, right? Yet, in Ramadan, you're saying, I am fasting, ana sa'im, I'm not hungry. I'm not hungry, otherwise I would eat, but I'm fasting. My tongue is fasting, is hungry, it cannot. You get my point, Sheikh? So Allah is telling us how to show that there are differences between you in Ramadan, your actual believer, the believer that is inside you. You see? لَعَلَّكُمْ تَتَّقُونَ, I want you to show your own self. This is your capacity. Your capacity is to prevent yourself from doing something that is halal. Come on. Ramadan is shaking you. You got my point? Allah is telling you that you are capable of preventing yourself from the lusts, and not only the lusts, from the main requirements of life, which is halal for the sake of Allah. So don't tell me that I can't do it. So 30 days, you prove to yourself that I can't deprive myself from halal. It will be very easy for you to deprive yourself from haram if you understood the impact of Ramadan. That's why we have something that a Quran will articulate you, will show the golden, the reality, the golden treasure inside yourself. It will show it. That's why, think about our actions. When we want to enter the masjid, we enter the masjid with which? With the right or the left? Which right? Tongue? Right what?
Feet.
Right feet, okay. At least you're awake. You enter the masjid with your right feet. When you want to exit the masjid to the dunya, which one? With the right as well? With the left, to the dunya. When you want to go from the dunya to the bathroom or to the toilet, with the left. When you want to go from the toilet to the dunya,
right.
From the dunya to the masjid,
right.
Do you understand why do you do this? Because you must think of your actions. What impact does it have? Your heart must be awake when you do physical activities. You're telling yourself now, I'm going out of the toilet to the dunya because the dunya is better than the toilet, so I'm going with the right feet. But when I'm going to from the dunya to the masjid, I'm going with the right feet. But when I'm going from the masjid to the dunya, I'm going down one step. Is this mentioned in the Holy Quran? In the Holy Quran? Is it? It is.
في بيوت أذن الله أن ترفع.
These, the houses of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, masajid, Allah has given it a privilege to be above the dunya.
أن ترفع ويذكر فيها اسمه يسبح له فيها بالغدو والآصال رجال
لا تلهيهم تجارة ولا بيع. سبحان الله. Allah is saying that Allah, the Almighty, the Most Exalted, has classified the dunya that you live in into three or four, or everything is not alike. The highest level is the mosques, is the masajid. في بيوت أذن الله أن ترفع. Above all. ويذكر فيها اسمه. And the name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has been mentioned there. يسبح له فيها بالغدو والآصال رجال. People are exalting Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala from the depth of their hearts. رجال لا تلهيهم تجارة. When they get into the masjid with their right feet, they won't think of anything that is lower. لا تلهيهم تجارة. Sales and commercial. لا تلهيهم تجارة ولا بيع عن ذكر الله. So do you feel it when you enter the mosque? That's why among the seven people who will win the shade of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in thereafter, ورجل قلبه, a man whose heart is always, he likes the high places. ورجل قلبه معلق بالمساجد. Whenever he stepped down with his left feet, he's thinking, so tell me about your heart. What does it attach to? I will tell you what impact has the ibadat have on you, the all world worships. That's why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when he mentioned about Surah Al-Hajj, and that is really something that there is a gap. Wallahi, once you fill this gap, you will live another life. I have, alhamdulillah, visited Mecca for pilgrimage, for Hajj, almost 10 times. May Allah ease it for every Muslim. And I was moving, giving da'wah from one compound to another compound. Different people, from different countries. Whenever I start my lecture, I would start with some questions. First, who amongst you have read any book about Hajj, about pilgrimage, that is written by human being? Everybody would raise their hand. Question number two, who has read Surah Al-Hajj, the chapter of Hajj, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, wallahi, no hand was shown. Then I would say, subhanallah, we have read everything about Hajj from everyone apart from the one who, to whom we make the Hajj, to whom we come to the Hajj. If you read Surah Al-Hajj, I'm saying that because I want to relate it to the Siyam, to the impact, to the indicators. Why aren't we just concentrate on what did Allah subhanahu say about Ramadan? And then this indicator, has it been achieved by me or not? Here's the success. If you want to be a hero, look, have you achieved the indicator or not? So I told them, so did to myself. We have read everything about that is written by someone else, apart from the one to whom we perform Hajj. If you read Surah Al-Hajj, you will not find the places, the main places for Hajj. What are the main places in Hajj? Mina, Muzdalifah, Arafah. Especially Arafah. the main point that you must be there during the Hajj. You must. If Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the entire chapter has not mentioned anything about Arafah, Muzdalifah and Mina, the question is, what does Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala say in Surah Al-Hajj? You will be amazed. It kept emphasizing on the indicator. Why are you here? Why are you here? The only one, how many pillar of Islam? Do you have prizes, or I will just give this as a prize?
Five.
Shall I give a drop for each of you? Yeah. Or just a sip? A drop, okay. So five. How many of the five has a specific surah in the Holy Quran?
Two.
What are they?
Hajj.
Okay.
And Salat.
There is a surah called Salat? Are you sure? For the Hajj, I wanted to give you the water. For the Salat, I will throw it back. But good try. Surah Al-Zakat. If you have a water, I will take it from you. طيب. So the only one is the Hajj. صح? The only one is the Hajj. How many times shall a Muslim may perform Hajj in his lifetime? 10, mashallah. You owed me 10 bottles of water.
Huh? Once.
Once, Allahu Akbar. You deserve it, Shaykh. Come. You deserve it. Wallahi, he deserve it. Takbir. Allahu Akbar. You deserve it, mashallah. So, look, guys. Look for the gaps that we need to fill in. It is an opportunity for improvement, wallahi, in our deen. Because you yourself will live another life. You will recite the Quran differently. You will face the hardships differently. Wallahi, you will live, just you will go through this life differently, through your problems, everything. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, it is the only one pillar that has a specific surah for it. And it is the only pillar that we perform it only once in our lifetime. How many times do we pray? 5 times a day. Ramadan, every year. Zakat, every year. Al-Hajj, once is enough for you. It is only once, but it will have an impact that lasts long. If it does touch your heart. Again, let us agree. I can do physical acts. Going every day to the masjid by right feet, going out with my left, going to the toilet, but has no, because I'm not thinking. I'm just, my heart and my extremities are disassociated. Everyone is working in its own way. Once you have them matched, what you're doing matches what your heart is feeling. Wallahi, your prayer will be a prayer, a real prayer. That's why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given you, for every good deed, Ashr Hasanat, 10 for every one deed, up to what? To 700. So who will get 10? And who will get 12? And who will get 400? And who will get 700? The more the matching is between your heart and your physical acts, the higher the reward will be. So it is the only one pillar. It is once in a lifetime. It doesn't say anything about the places of Mecca. Allahu Akbar. And if you read all the verses, I will not go through them all, but I'll just have some snapshot from here and there. To know how much the gap is that we need to fill in to get this heart attached to the physical activities. Ya Rabb, a'inna ya Rabb. What does Surah Al-Hajj talk about if it doesn't mention anything about the places of the Hajj? What does it talk about, Shaykh? Yawm al-Qiyamah. Allahu Akbar. Every time you will find the word Al-Hajj, you will find an indicator about two things. The first thing is the taqwa. Is the taqwa the same as the fasting? And the second part within each verse, there will be a mentioning of Al-Qiyamah. What does Al-Qiyamah have to do with my Hajj? This is the impact that the Quran will leave in your heart. Why taqwa? Just why taqwa? Why taqwa with Al-Hajj? Why taqwa with Al-Siyam? Why being righteous as an indicator? Why? Do you think that what is the main purpose of every ibadah? Any ibadah in the world. If you do it, you need to see the amount of taqwa that has been changed in your life. Do you have any ayah that says that all the ibadat is to keep your taqwa being top up? Is there any ayah? If you say the ayah, you will win £20. Otherwise, it will be given to me, back to me. Yalla. What is the ayah that says that all the ibadat were decreed upon us to have an impact on your taqwa? So if how many ibadah am I doing today a day? So how many times should my taqwa be being topped up? If you get it wrong, I will take £1. If you get it right, you take £20. Go ahead.
Is it three?
What?
It's three.
What is three? You're not sure. Yalla, Sheikh. The last try.
10.
What is 10? It is like if I ask you what is your name and you said I study in high school. anyway, let me just. Yalla, go ahead. Huh? Okay. My £20 is back. Yeah, go ahead. Last.
Not.
So three and not. Jazakumullahu khairan. The ibadah, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, Allah said it as a big umbrella that all the ibadat must have an impact on your taqwa. So whenever you do any ibadah, you must see something, some impact in your heart. And then Allah has specified every ibadah as a standalone ibadah, and He indicated taqwa with it. يا أيها الناس اعبدوا ربكم الذي خلقكم والذين من قبلكم لعلكم تتقون. This is the first command in the Quran, in Surah Al-Baqarah. Oh you people, worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. What is the indicator that will be shown if I do all this ibadat? لَعَلَّكُمْ تَتَّقُونَ. So you may be righteous. So you must feel something. So why would Allah say in Surah Al-Hajj about Yawm Al-Qiyamah? Why would Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gather these 3 million and they will move to Arafah at once, and they move to Mina at once, and they move to Al-Haram at once? Allah could have said, okay, then one third in here, one third in there. No, He wants you to feel the how to be shoulder to shoulder and to feel the crowd with people whom you don't know, with different levels. You will find someone who is a billionaire just shoulder to shoulder to someone who is in the most immense and severe poverty. They are shoulder to shoulder. They are just going around the Kaaba. Why would they all wear this the same clothes? Because they will be the same thereafter, with the same crowd. So why would they have different levels? Someone is just closed. The compound is just 5-star compound, and the other compound is 3-star compound. Why? Because Allah will want to tell you that there will be different. وَيَوْمَ تَقُومُ السَّاعَةُ يَوْمَئِذٍ يَتَفَرَّقُونَ. So Allah wants you to test it. That's why Allah says in the Quran, الحج أشهر مع وذكر الله في أيام معدودات. Mention and remember Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in a few counted days. فمن تعجل في يومين, whoever wants to leave 2 days ahead, he can. ومن تأخر فلا إثم عليه. Whoever wants to stay for 2 days, فلا إثم عليه. لمن, for whom? لمن اتقى. Whoever has taken the lesson right. The ayah has not ended yet. واتقوا الله. And then fear Allah. واعلموا. Take the home message. واعلموا. And then know. Know what? أنكم إليه تحشرون. That you will be returned to him in the in thereafter. I have given you a sample to feel how the crowd would be in the sun, under the sun, for 5 days. So you may remember, and whenever you act or whenever you do any deed, you remember that there people will be different, will be resurrected differently. So you, why? Because they were preparing before they joined Hajj. Before they came to the compound, they were preparing themselves. So with Ramadan, how we will prepare ourselves? Aisha radiallahu anha, the wife of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, she says, Al-Nabi alayhi salatu wa salam has never fasted any month as a whole month except for Sha'ban. He fasted all Sha'ban illa qaleela, except a few days. Why would he prepare himself? Imagine a football team that just rested for 6 months and then they joined the league. Would they perform well? They must prepare, exercise, any type of sukkur, any type, even in your exams, if you don't prepare, you won't pass. So when Nabi alayhi salam was preparing from Sha'ban, he was fasting. The issue here that Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam, within Ramadan, he will be a different man. He's always doing his best. But when it comes to Ramadan, everything will be excelled, boosted, uplifted. Everything. That's why the Qiyam fil Layl, night prayer, will be prolonged. As Ramadan goes, the effort increases. Unlike most of us who started in last Ramadan, started very well at the beginning of Ramadan, then they kept declining. Why? Because they have not prepared themselves. So they did all their effort, all their capacity in the first 10 days. When have you seen any race? Like for example, horse race. You will find the horse, even when it is an animal, but it won't start fast and then reduce the speed. It's the opposite. As it approaches the end, the speed will be increased. That's why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has made the holy month, as you approach the end, everything has been changing with you, because you should have been prepared and you should have been increasing, because every ibadah you do, it must bring another ibadah with it. Did Allah say that in the Quran? Yes. Allah says, وَالَّذِينَ اهْتَدَوْا, those who have been guided rightly and performing well, what will happen? زَادَهُمْ هُدَى, it will increase their hidayah, their guidance, and open more doors for them and help them more. وَالَّذِينَ اهْتَدَوْا زَادَهُمْ هُدَى. What is the end of the verse? وَآتَاهُمْ تَقْوَاهُمْ. And Allah has given them the indicator, the taqwa, the fear of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So as they rejected the water while it's halal, they will reject something that is haram. So they will see the fear in themselves and the love to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the love for the ibadah to move forward. So I will conclude with this. شهر رمضان الذي أنزل فيه القرآن. The month of Ramadan is that month in which the Quran was revealed. Why? That's why Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam said that every Ramadan كان يعارضه جبريل القرآن. Gabriel was going through the Quran, not revising as memory, not memorizing, revising the Quran as a contemplation every Ramadan. And in the year where Nabi alayhi salam died, how many times they went through the Quran? Twice. That's why the Sahabi, he says, the companion says, Nabi alayhi salam was to be the most generous man that they have ever seen. وَكَانَ أَجْوَدْ مَا يَكُونَ. He will reach his highest level when it comes to Ramadan, when he reviewed the Quran with Jibreel. He just wanted to give us an example how generous was Nabi al-Salam was at that time. He said, كَرِّيحِ الْمُرْسَلَ. Like the wind, when it's raining and the wind is so strong that it will just, you cannot count the drops of water, of rain, and nothing is just facing it. Nothing could stand for it. So he would be given everything. Ajwad Mayakun, this is one of the impacts of the Holy Quran on him. So this is the point that I want to conclude with. What effects the Quran may have on us? Always, the Quran is talking about two things. If you understand these two things, wallahi, inshallah, hopefully, your life will be changing. The Quran is talking about an action and an impact of that action. Sometimes that action is an injury, which everybody is concentrating on always. We relate harm to injuries. صح? We would say, the more injuries you have, the more pain you will have. Is this true? The more injuries, the more pain? No. I'll give you an example. And why the Quran is emphasizing on this. Have you ever seen your kid, one of your kids, riding a bicycle, and all of a sudden he hit something and he fell down? And it touches your, not touches your heart, it hits your heart, and you thought that he is in a severe pain. And you just came to him, hastened to him, and he said, I'm okay. I would say, no way. Are you sure? He says, yes, I'm okay. So the injury hits you more than him. You get my point? Sometimes you see someone who is in the second level, the second floor, and he fell down. And that if we have a device to measure the amount of pain that you and him has, you will find that you have more pain and more panic and more fear than him. Have you seen this? Wallahi, ya mashayikh, myself, I had a car accident. I was in the passenger seat. We were driving at 120 kilometers an hour in a highway. A kid, was driving, was not caring about anything. He came 160 kilometers and he entered from the side track to the highway without even bothering to look at who's just on his left. Wallahi, the car hits this kid's car, and he was like he was thrown to us like a rock or a. And when he hits us, our car flipped over 5 times or 6 times. The car was smashed to become almost one half or one third of its original size. Most of the damage occurs on my side. So subhanallah, I got out of the car and I prostrated to Allah in the street, thanking him. And this is from the sunnah. When you have something that Allah has given you more than what you're having, you just thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So I prostrated to Allah. Wallahi, I was listening to one guy. He was looking at the car. He said, was there anyone in the passenger seat? Someone told him yes. He said, no way. Where is he? Wallahi, he said a sentence that it touches the, now, wallahi, my hair is just... He says, if there was an ant, such a tiny insect, in that seat, it will be killed. The car was smashed. I don't know where, how did I jump? Don't ask me. The car was moving all over the place. The only thing that I felt was something. Only one thing. Guess what?
Pain.
No, wallahi, I was prostrating to Allah. The only thing that I noticed, my eyeglasses. It was loose. Wallahi, when I took it, it fitted correctly. I said, subhanAllah, it touches just only my eyeglasses. Then I realized that's what why the Quran is talking about the injury and the impact of the injury. And that's why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that you have two angels in the Quran, in Surah Al-Ra'd. You have two angels that are one in front, one in the back. لَهُ مُعَقِّبَاتٌ مِّن بَيْنِ يَدَيْهِ وَمِنْ خَلْفِهِ. Angels surrounding him. يَحْفَظُونَ. They protect him. مِنْ أَمْرِ اللَّهِ. What does that mean? Ali ibn Talib radiallahu anhu and Ibn Abbas, the companion, interpreted this ayah and they said that the mu'aqibat are the angels. They are protecting him with the commandment of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And whenever Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants the creed, the qadr, the decree to hit him, those angels will be moving away. That's why you will find someone who's been injured with a tiny injury, and you will see the pain and the impact is so severe. And you will find that on the other hand, a man in the car who is smashed all over the place and nothing has happened. So Allah is testing us with the injuries, but He controls the pain, subhanahu wa ta'ala. That's why if you go to Burma, you will find people are now reciting the Quran and revising the Quran on a daily basis. And when you ask anyone, they would say, Alhamdulillah. You would say, how would you say Alhamdulillah within all these calamities? I was in Turkey and I visited some injured, wallahi, one of them is injured people. One of them just 3 months ago, he was the two legs from the thighs were amputated. So he lost all of his lower extremities. If you see him, you would never think that if I get a picture for him, of him, you will never say that this man, this trunk, from the abdomen to the head, related to the same body, where there's no extremities. He was smiling and laughing. I said, how are you? He said, Alhamdulillah. I said, how was your injury? He said, Alhamdulillah, inshallah, this will be in front of me in Jannah. A kid, who told him this? This is the last trick. If, I will give an example of you guys. Guys, it's your names? Sheikh, what's your name? Asmik al-Kareem, what's your name?
Firas.
Firas. Muhammad. Firas and Muhammad have to go to the court tomorrow. Just kidding, huh? An example. Firas has to pay £1 million. Has to pay it. If not, he will be sent to jail. Muhammad has to pay £100,000. If not, he will go to jail. Imagine who should suffer more? Firas, صح? Firas, صح? He may not be able to sleep tonight, صح? True, because the pain is proportionate to the injury, صح? What if I come tonight and I have a check of £2 million and I gave it to Firas? And I move to Muhammad's house, who must pay 100,000, and I gave him only 10,000 pounds. Who is suffering more now? Muhammad. Although Firas should be suffering more, صح? But the amount of compensation that I gave to Firas is by far. Did you get the point? That's why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala may give you the same injury externally, but He will compensate for Firas. That's why when you ask Firas while he's diagnosed with cancer and you said, how are you? He said, Alhamdulillah. Maybe Muhammad is feeling his toothache and he's just crying, screaming, what is this life? Subhanallah, that's mentioned in every story in the Holy Quran. And here is the test that Allah subhanahu will test you. Once you understand the Quran, you will understand this principle very clearly. And you will never think about the pain because it is in Allah's hand. And you may ask Allah to always compensate for you. That's why Ibrahim alayhi salam, when he was Ibrahim, peace be upon him, when he was thrown in the hellfire, He was thrown in the hellfire, صح? The surrounding environment with Ibrahim is better than the surrounding environment of the people who initiated the fire, صح? صح or not? So the injury is more, but it was cold. Not only cold, and peace surrounding Ibrahim. While those people who started, initiated the fire, they still felt the heat of the fire. So the main question is, what is the impact of our ibadat in Ramadan or any other ibadat, but especially in Ramadan, where the doors of heaven are open, the doors of hellfire are closed, and the shaitans has been chained, are chained, and the Quran is there, the fasting is there. Your heart must be softened because of the siyam and the qiyam. Always, please, when you prostrate to Allah, ask Allah to make you and to grant you tawfiq, to make you and support, to make you the best among everybody else in the Ramadan, to help you. Because if Allah helps you, no one can compete you. That's why one of the easiest ibadah ever is the dhikr, mentioning Allah with your tongue, and not everybody is being supported to do it, right? So why people are remembering Allah and others are not? Because Allah is supporting them. Why Allah has supported them? Because they strive to get the support. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us the tawfiq in Ramadan and in all our life. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala shower His mercy upon all of us. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant each and every one of us more than what He desired. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reward those who have arranged this event and the brothers and sisters who attended this. Jazakumullah khairan. Wa sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Muhammad.
Jazakumullah khair. I know many parents are eager to take their children home.
Allah understand.
But we just have maybe your attention, just 5 more minutes for a few question and answers, maybe, inshallah, and then we'll finish, inshallah, before 8 o'clock, I promise. Inshallah, we'll let you go and take the children. So, if there are any questions that any brothers or any sisters would like to ask from downstairs, the sisters can message. If one of the sisters and they can message the question up to me. If there's any questions from the brothers upstairs. Yes, Sheikh.
Have you ever gone to Algeria?
What's the thing? Sorry? What's the question?
Have you ever been to Algeria?
Have you ever been to Algeria?
Very good question. Very good question. Wallahi, I wish, inshallah, and I'm planning to. But jazakallah khair, that indicates that your iman is really strong, that you need to spread the message of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and to deliver the message to your own people. Like what Allah subhanahu says to Nabi alayhi salatu salam, وَأَنذِرْ عَشِيرَتَكَ الْأَقْرَبِينَ, start with the people who are among us you and around you. Jazakallah khair, Sheikh. And inshallah I will go there, and inshallah I will meet you there. May Allah reward you, Allah. MashaAllah, MashaAllah.
Sheikh, I have a question.
Yes.
Inshallah, as many of us know, the days...
He will ask the question and he will answer himself, no, because he's a da'i, he knows better than me. Yeah.
So, as many of us know, the days are going to be very long and hot maybe as well. Any advice how to deal with the long days and the hot weather?
Jazakumullah khair. Yes, Jazakumullah khair. Look, what if I say to any one of you, every second has passed of the day of Ramadan, you will receive a text that £1 is being credited to your account. Every second, £1. Every second, £1. So when would you break your fast? In Sha'ban. Next year. If you feel it, wallahi, that's why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that the hearts have eyes. Allah says, فَإِنَّهَا لَا تَعْمَلْ أَبْصَارِ. It's not the eyes that get blind. It's the qulub. Have you seen a kid who's playing and every level he passes, there will be an indicator of something, a reward? That's why he will never, he doesn't want anyone to stop him. صح? Real believers, they see it. They see it entering their account. They are credited. Every second they pass, it's a test. They are gaining more and more. That's why some people will be happier and happier as time passes. And some people will get struggled because they don't see the account being credited. That's what we're talking about. If I'm doing physical activities, but the heart is disassociated, the heart is not in the equation, you will never feel it. That's why Nabi alayhi salam said, "Man sama Ramadana, whoever fasts Ramadan, imanan, believing in it, wahtisaban." What does ihtisaban mean? Someone is looking at the computer and see how much has been credited in his, what do they call it? The financial people, what do they call it when you just keep staring at?
Stock exchange.
Is it stock exchange? Yeah. So, ihtisaban means that you are counting and you are just thinking about how much reward have been credited into you. You see? So, every second you pass, you will be rewarded more and more and more. And alhamdulillah, we remember how many Ramadan have we fasted? Years? Many years. Where is the harm or the hardship of these previous Ramadans? It has gone. صح? The thirst has gone. The hunger has gone. But the reward is waiting for you. And every atom of good deed, every atom, Allah says in Surah Zalzala, every atom of good deeds that enters your account, you shall see it. You shall see it in yourself, in your health, in your wealth, in your beloved ones, on the face of the earth, in your grave, and thereafter. But wallahi, every atom that reaches there, you shall see it. So if I'm sure that I will see it, and alhamdulillah, you thank Allah that many countries are in poverty and they are fasting, but they don't know when to break their fast. Because they don't have food. But you know when you will you break your fast. So when you pray for them, your prayer will taste differently. The flavor of your prayer, when you feel the thirst and you say, oh, I know that I will break my fast in 2 hours, they don't know when to break their fast. Is it in 2 days, in 3 days? Don't know. So I don't want to touch the medical aspect of the benefits of fasting. Wallahi, it's beyond our capacity to mention the benefits of fasting into your body and how to get rid of these toxins that we have been loading our bodies with. Non-Muslims fast, but with no reward. They don't fast for the sake of Allah. They fast for the sake of their bodies. So you get benefit while you are rewarded here and in thereafter. Again, no one can support you, no one can open the eyes of your heart except Allah. You must ask Allah extensively, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will make it easy for you. For those وَالَّذِينَ جَاهَدُوا فِينَا, whoever strives toward the best, Allah will guide them to the right path. Ya Rabbi,
wafiqna ya Rabbi. Inshallah, we have one question from the sister, and then we'll probably finish. So the sister is asking, What kind of action would you recommend during Ramadan as will give you the most benefit?
Allahu Akbar. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, شَهْرُ رَمَضَانِ الَّذِي أُنزِلَ فِيهِ الْقُرْآنِ. So keep listening to the Quran, keep contemplating in the Holy Quran. the prayers at their time, because when the companion asked Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam, ayyul a'mali ahab, which of the deeds are the best to in the eyes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he says as-salatu ala waqtiha, the prayer on time. So keep your prayer on time. Your tongue does not require anything, does not require money, does not require physical strength, does not require wudu, does not require going to Mecca. Keep your tongue and lips moisturized with dhikrullah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Keep tasbih, subhanallah, alhamdulillah, rabbi ghafirli, rabbi a'inni, oh ya Allah, strengthening me, ya Allah, strengthen me, strengthen my iman, ya Allah, help me. The more you ask Allah to help you, the more you will see ibadat are becoming easier and easier. Those ibadat that you were struggling with are just becoming a piece of cake. So keep your tongue. Even when you're cooking, keep your tongue. سبح الله تذكر الله لا إله إلا أنت سبحانك إني كنت من الظالمين. Get in your mobile or in a recorder or whatever, just or your laptop. Get the Quran. It's been recited, and just try to recite with it. Try to contemplate of the meaning. Try that every, even if you're not Arabic speaker, try every day at least you contemplate on one verse, just to know what is it. What does it say, and what impacts could it have on your hearts? And have you ever tried this? And ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to open your heart, to understand it, and to apply it. So, al-siyam, al-qiyam, and the salawat. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reward you, ya Rabbil Alameen.
Astaghfirullah. I'll just one more question, then we'll finish. I promise we'll finish before 8 o'clock. We've got 4 minutes.
Sheikh, he should say, should answer the question.
The question I wanted to ask is that a lot of the children, they're not able to fast the whole day because it's a long day.
MashaAllah.
And what advice can you give to some of the children and the parents?
MashaAllah.
How they can gradually get them to, and also what sort of ideas can children expect and the benefit for them?
MashaAllah.
Can you repeat the question, sisters?
Yes, yes. MashaAllah. Sheikh asked a very important and interesting question. He says, for our beloved children with such a long days, how can they train themselves? What is the reward? How do they and their parents can, what can they do to start their training sessions in Ramadan? Now I will ask our beloved young lads. I haven't asked the question. You raise your hand. Yeah, go ahead, answer. Give me the answer. When did you start walking? Yeah.
3 years old.
3 years old. Before that, what were you doing?
Crawling.
And before that? You were not moving at all, right? If you keep that moving at all, you will never be crawling, صح? And you, if you just don't try to flip over or try to crawl, you will never be able to stand. And then you stand, and then you stand for 2 steps, and then you fall, right? If you keep there, you will never move. But you must start training. So if you can fast for 2 hours, go ahead. The next day, make it as a challenge. You're a man. You're a believer. You are a man, yes. So try to make it 3 hours. If you can, if you can't, then just drink. Then try to ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the same day, Ya Rabbi, I have done it 3 hours. Ya Allah, help me to go for 3.5, 3.5. Then you will be rewarded for these trials. وَالَّذِينَ جَاهَدُوا فِينَا. And even parents, they can reward their beloved kids. You make it 4 hours, just test yourself. How much do you do? People are sport athletes, they do it. They challenge themselves. So like anyone who plays any difficult game in PlayStation, do you like it when it becomes more difficult?
Yeah.
You like it, right? Because you like the challenge, right? Because you can do something that others, you would say, oh, look, I've reached this level. Yet, if it was an easy level, there is no competition. صح? So every group of people, of young lad, just try to make a competition. Who can make it more? Okay? And every time you hit a limit, you ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah won't blame you, but Allah will give you for every second. And every second you try, Allah will give you. Even if you break your fast earlier, Allah will give you for the niyyah, for the intention. But it's really great that you set yourself as a mature person and you try challenging yourself. Life needs challenging. There are many hardships that you need to overcome. So just try yourself. And every time if you hit the 3 hours and you cannot tolerate it, go ahead and drink. But please, make a sincere prayer to the kids who don't have anything to eat or to drink. They can have nothing to break their fast. You will feel something that is amazing. You will feel that there is a strong bond with your brothers and sisters all over the world. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala help us and strengthen our iman, ya Rabbil Alameen. Jazakumullah khair.
JazakAllah khair for everyone, and JazakAllah khair for the Shaykh in the time with us, and inshallah we pray that we will benefit and may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reward us for. As I said, inshallah, JazakAllah khair for the parents who staying behind, and inshallah may Allah make this Ramadan easy to us. Assalamu alaikum wa
rahmatullahi
wa barakatuh. Subhanallah wa bihamdika, ashhadu an la ilaha illa anta, astaghfiruka wa atubu ilayk.
JazakAllah khair.